chapter 15. As 47 verses. Hope that God will be pleased with us during our worship hour to read all 47 verses. If you have your Bible, open it to Mark 15. If you don't have yours, we provided the words from the text on the screen. Meditate on them as I read them aloud. Immediately in the morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and delivered him to Pilate. Then Pilate asked, "Are you the King of the Jews?" He answered and said to him, "It is as you say." And the chief priest accused him of many things, but he answered nothing. Then Pilate asked him again, saying, "Do you answer nothing? See how many things they testify against you." But Jesus still answered nothing, so that Pilate marveled. Now at the feast, he was accustomed to releasing a prisoner to whom ever they requested. And there was one named Barabbas, and he was chained with his fellow rebels. They had committed murder in the rebellion. And then the multitude, crying aloud, began to ask him to do just as he had always done for them. But Pilate answered them, saying, "Do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?" For he knew that the chief priest had handed him over because of envy. But the chief priest stirred up the crowd so that he should rather release Barabbas to them. Pilate answered, said to them again, "What then do you want me to do with him whom you call King of the Jews?" And they cried out again, "Crucify him." Then Pilate said to them, "Why? What evil has he done?" They cried out all the more, "Crucify him." And so Pilate, wanting to gratify the crowd, released Barabbas to them and delivered Jesus. And if you brought your Bible, underline, "after he had scourged him." To be crucified. Then the soldiers led him away to the hall called Praetorium, and they called together the whole garrison. You learn that a garrison is about 600 men, 600 soldiers. They clothed him with purple. They twisted a crown of thorns, put it on his head, began to salute him, "Hail, King of the Jews." They struck him on the head, the reed, spelled. Bowing the knee, they worshiped him. And then when they had mocked him, took the purple off him, put his own clothes on him, led him out to crucify. Somebody say crucify. Then they compelled a certain man. This is our key verse. We'll be concluding this mini series with the essence of verse 21. Then they compelled a certain man, Simon, a Cyrenian, the father of Alexander and Rufus, as he was coming out of the country and passing by, to bear his cross. One more time, in your Bible, just underline, to bear his cross. To bear his cross. I want to look at this crucifixion through Simon's eyes, to bear his cross. And they brought him to the place Golgotha, which is translated place of a skull. And then they gave him wine mingled with myrrh to drink, but he did not take it. Just one last time, underline, and they crucified him. For emphasis sake, all the other is backdrop to this phrase, and they crucified him. Divided his garments, casting lots for them to determine what every man should take. Another real key part of the whole scenario is verse 25. Now it was the third hour, and they crucified him. The inscription of his accusation was written above the king of the Jews. With him they also crucified two robbers, one on the right, the other on the left. This was done so that the scripture was fulfilled, which says, he was numbered with the transgressors. Watch the scenario continue. And those who passed by blasphemed him, wagging their heads and saying, aha! You who destroyed the temple and built it in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross. Likewise, the chief priests also mocking among themselves with the scribes, said, he saved others. He saved others. He saved others. Himself he cannot save. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, descend now from the cross that we may see and believe. And even those who were crucified with him reviled him. Verse 33. Now when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which is translated, y'all say it with me, my God, some of those who stood by, when they heard that, said, look, he's calling for Elijah. Then someone ran and filled a sponge full of sour wine, put it on a reed, and offered it to him to drink, saying, let him alone. Let us see if Elijah will come and take him down. Jesus cried out with a loud voice and breathed his last. Then the veil of the temple was torn in two from the top to the bottom. So when the centurion who stood opposite him saw that he cried out like this and breathed his last, he said, truly, this man was the Son of God. There were women looking on from afar, among whom were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James the Less, and of Joseph and Salome, who also followed him and ministered to him when he was in Galilee, and many other women who came up with him to Jerusalem. Now when evening had come, because it was the preparation day, that is the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, a prominent council member who was himself waiting for the kingdom of God, coming in, taking courage, went into Pilate, asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate marveled that he was already dead. And summoning the centurion, he asked him if he had been dead for some time. So when he found out from the centurion, he granted the body to Joseph. And then he brought fine linen, took him down, wrapped it in linen, laid him in a tomb, which had been hewn out of a rock, rolled a stone against the door of the tomb. And Mary Magdalene, and Mary, the mother of Joseph, observed where they laid him. I believe that in order for this to grasp and tug at your heart, if the biblical writer had had access to the internet and the technology that we had, because we are visual people. Many of us are left-brained. We get more out of seeing. The words paint the picture, but let's use some technology. Is that all right? I tried this on you a couple of times to just get some reaction, see if it had the effect on you that it's had on me. But some of you are not here. And so lest you feel shortchanged. Now Courtney is gonna work with me. We've not had a rehearsal of this. But there are three pictures here. Each of them deals very dramatically with different aspects of this. When the Bible says, and they scourged him, We read that and pass right on by. Here's what's behind. And they scourged him. My prayer is that as you read his word, never again would you just read it and light the Passover. And the technology will bring us up to date. We try to do this with the text, but to see it as graphic, I believe, puts us in a different place. It was customary for the criminal to carry the cross piece, it's called the pedibulum, to the place of execution. After carrying his own cross, the text says, and they crucified him, following the scourge, they crucified him. Deuteronomy 23 verse 21 says, cursed is every man that hangs on a tree. Darkness over all the land from the sixth to the ninth hour. Courtney, is there a way to pause that? Only Mark gives us the time that the process started. He says, and it was the third hour, and they crucified him. He does not give up the ghost, or he does not die until the ninth hour. 6 hours. See, crucifixion was a slow death. Was devised by the Carthaginians to be the most hideous way to execute a human being. The Carthaginians invented it, but the Romans perfected it. And in Rome in the first century, it was commonplace. 30 years prior to the crucifixion, the Caesar had ordered the crucifixion death of 2,000 Jews. It was the government's way of saying to a segment of its society, you don't matter. Our precious society would be better off if you weren't a part of it. His humiliation was threefold. It was what the government was saying to him. It was what the people were saying to him. People that he had healed their sick, given sight to their blind, raised their dead. Don't you hear him saying, you saved others, yes. Save yourself. The next time you get ridiculed by folk that you have done a lot for, and you are crushed, and you contemplate all kinds of things, remember Jesus. Darkness from the sixth to the ninth hour. But crucifixion started at the third hour. 6 hours he hung. When they offered him the sour wine mixed with myrrh, scholars suggest it was a narcotic. It was something that was designed to lessen the pain. But he wouldn't drink. If you could take something that could lessen the pain, why not take it? Why did he refuse it? He refused it because he said, I'm not going to do anything to lessen the pain. I'm going to drink this cup to its bitter dregs. This is a drip by drip kind of death. And I'm going to take every drop of it, and I'm not going to seek any relief. Oh, how he loved us. While the 6 hour was passing, remember, he had the power to step down from the cross. If you had the power to lessen your pain, we can't even stand a headache without running for the Advil. I'm sorry, y'all don't do Advil. Tylenol. That helped me. He had the power. He could have stepped down from the cross anytime he wanted to. See, that's why they said they took his life. No, 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 no. You didn't take my life. I gave my life. The Bible says, for the joy set before him. So what kept you on the cross, Jesus? You could have come down. You had disciples who were called sons of thunder, wanted to bring down fire from heaven. Why didn't you do that, Jesus? What kept him on the cross was his love for me. Embrace little boy, little girl stuff. And I know you've gone through some hurts. And then he's watching while he's conscious. He looks and they've taken his garments, taken his robe. It's the only thing he has. Imagine watching folk take all you got. Bad enough they're killing you. You gotta watch them take. He's got two pieces. He's got a inner garment that's more like a linen. He's got an outer robe. They take the inner garment and they divide it into pieces so that each of the soldiers could have one. When they get to his outer garment, it's too nice of a piece of clothing. It's woven in one piece. And they say, let us not rend it. Let us not tear it. Let's cast lots. Let's roll the dice and see which one ought to get it. They are dividing up the spoils of a man they have dehumanized, lied on, spat on him, beaten him almost senseless. Crucifixion was designed to be public. They wanted everybody to see. And what was being said to every passerby, there is a criminal. To the Jews, it said, that's somebody who is cursed by God. Because Deuteronomy 21 says, cursed by God is everybody that hangs on him. Do you see what was being said about him? Golgotha, the place of the skull, was an elevated part of a hill side, on a hill. The cross stood on a hill so everybody could see it. And this is a society where men didn't wear shorts. And some of the pictures you see where the crucified person has his little tunic on. That was not crucifixion. These men were naked. In a society where it was a shame for a man to be exposed. He was to die from exposure. They would hang there for days. The pain of the cross is not the nails in his hands. It's not the nails in his feet. And I want you to have experience through technology of watching that. Because sometimes when we say they crucified him, we really don't see it. Let me pause. Courtney. Thank you. I only have 2 points after this, and we'll be through. Squeamish. Despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Surely he had borne our griefs, carried our sorrows, and yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he opened it. Out his mouth, led as a lamb to the slaughter, as a sheep before his shearer is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. Later on in Isaiah's writings, he says, he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bore the sins of many and made intercession for the transgressors. Listen, he was numbered with the transgressors so that transgressors could be numbered with the saints. Glory to God. A transgressor.
Yes.
He was numbered with the transgressors.
Yes.
So that transgressors could be numbered with the saints.
Yes.
That's why I worship him.
Yes.
That's why I worship ought to mean something.
That's right.
Let's go back to the text. Make these two points. And we'll be finished. I really need to say this to us in the church. Okay. Point number one. Never underestimate the power of truth. Trivial is something that's small. And at the time may seem rather unimportant. But as things develop, you see how huge it is. I asked the class Wednesday night, I asked the Thursday morning class, if you would pull up some trivial in your life that at the time seemed small. But as life progressed, you realized the importance of it. Can I give you some trivials that have been happening here lately? Is Dion and Melissa here? Oh, so
Y'all tell them I used them in the illustration. And shepherds, when you know now somebody's not here, you know, just a telephone call can seem like a trip.
That's right.
Yes, sir.
That's right.
A visit from a shepherd.
Yeah.
May seem like a trivial. But in the larger scheme, it may save somebody's soul.
Yeah.
Let me hurry up with these 2 points. A.C. Crispin uses technology. He has a, I don't know whether it's a blog or it's something. It's on the web. Melissa was looking for someone to perform a wedding ceremony between her and Dion. And went online and saw Crispin. Lee, we gotta get our website like it ought to be.
That's right. That's right.
Amen. Amen. When she found Crispin, he had a list of things that he's ordained to do. One of them is do a wedding. So she called him. Trivial. Seemed like a small thing. I want you to see how God will use. That's what I'm trying. Little stuff. Crispin said, yeah, I'll do a wedding. When he met them to talk about the ceremony, found out that Dion's father and AC were classmates. So sure, I'll do the wedding. Did the wedding, and then Dion said, we'd like to talk to somebody that could really help us put in perspective some things about this marriage.
Yeah.
Said, I'd like to talk to an older preacher. The small thing. Crispin said, I got one that you need to talk to. God used that to allow this preacher to sit down with this couple who were not members of the church and go through Ephesians chapter 5, which talks about the marriage relationship against the background of the relationship between Christ and the church. That's why when you get to the end of the chapter, he says, this is a great mystery, but I speak concerning Jesus and the church. So that study is blessing their marriage, but it also was used to lead them to faith. And this morning, they are members of the church bought with the blood of Jesus. You see that? Never, never discount the trivial things because you don't know how God will use them. How does that apply to you? A smile. Come on, somebody. A warm handshake. Or telling somebody, we don't shake hands here. We embrace. What will God do with that kind of church? A little trivial. You see a young man standing off against the wall in the foyer by himself with all of us going out hugging and kissing and laughing. And he's standing over there by himself and somebody sees it. Trivial.
Yeah.
And you go over there and say, I'm glad you're here. I don't know you. What's your name? You embrace it.
Yes.
Trivial. Oh my God, can take what little things
yes, he can.
We do. So never underestimate power.
Something that looks trivial. When you go out of here, be trying to find your trivial. If you live very long, you've seen them in your life. You're going down the turnpike, and the 18-wheeler is overturned on its side. It caused a five-car pileup. And you realize, had I been just a little bit earlier,
that's a trick. Yeah. See how God was using it?
Yeah. And you were mad at your wife because she made you late leaving home to get on the turnpike, on the trip, and God used it to save your life. I'm talking about how little stuff can be used by God. I never will forget the flight that didn't depart from Will Rogers when it was supposed to. Had a connection in Chicago, missed the connection. Took a later flight, got to where I was going, and noticed when I in the airport something was going on. Bewilderment on the faces of people. People crying. I'm trying to figure out what's going on, only to find out
that there was a plane crash. It was an American Eagle flight. And then I learned that it was the flight that I was supposed to be. Trivial. Little stuff. Have you ever been there? Oh, come on, somebody. Have you been blessed by turning right when maybe you should have turned left? How does that have to do with the text? Simon, not in the processional, not in that group going up to Golgotha's hill to see him crucified. He's coming out of the country. In fact, he's going the other direction. Look at the trivial. The centurion looks this way and sees Simon. Had he looked that way, wouldn't have seen and compel Simon to help Jesus bear his cross. He would have been written out of biblical history were it not for that truth. Somebody said, well, Crenshaw, it didn't matter nothing. Yes, it did. Put on the screen Romans chapter 16. And then I'm going to give you one other passage in Acts chapter 13. But Romans chapter 16. And Courtney, you really have blessed me. Thank you. Thank you for working with me.
Sure.
At verse 13. Remember in the text, his name is Simon. He's a Cyrenian. He's from Cyrene. That's northern Africa. Bronze colored because of the African sun. You know, some folks say he was black. I don't know whether he was or not. I just know he was African. He's from northern Africa. I also know that he is, Courtney, if you would, go back to Mark 15 and verse 21. And then I'm going to come back to this. I just want you to make the connection. Make this connection real quickly and we'll be through. Then they compelled a certain man, Simon, a Cyrenian. Here's a little bit more information. He is the father of who? And okay. So he's a Cyrenian. But he's also the father of Alexander and Rufus. Now go to Acts. And I'm in Romans. We'll get to Acts in a minute. Go to Romans chapter 16.
Look at verse 13. Now, remember that Mark wrote his gospel from Rome. And so Mark has a lot of connection with the church at Rome. Paul comes along and he is closing out his epistle to the church at Rome. He's greeting people that he's made, built relationships with. One of them was Rufus. Greet Rufus, chosen in the Lord, and his mother and mine. Which suggests that Rufus was one of the leaders in the church at Rome. And Paul had built a relationship with that family to the point that Rufus's mother was like his mother. You ought to build relationships in your church family. I believe that that's the same Rufus whose father was Simon. Look at Acts chapter 13. Verse 1 says, now in the church that was at Antioch, there were some great churches in the Bible. Church at Jerusalem, perhaps. Other than that one, none much greater than the church at Antioch. Now in the church that was at Antioch, there were certain prophets and teachers. And he names them Barnabas, Simon. You say Simeon. Depends on whether you're from Tulsa or Oklahoma City. Who was called Niger. Niger links something about his color, really. He's called Niger. His name was Simeon or Simon. He's called Niger. I'm trying to be diplomatic. Niger has something to do with the color of his skin. Yeah. It is no accident. Simon, called black, the night. Look who he's standing next to. Lucius. Y'all know how sometimes based on skin color we set it. Amen. I'm sure trying to step lightly here, but you ever wondered why you go in a room why the black folks sit together and the white folks sit together? Y'all sure not helping. Thank God for James Bond. Amen. Thank God for you brethren and sisters. And I want us to get to a point where we don't have to sit together based on skin color. Y'all, I ain't got one preaching, y'all. So there's some stuff I need to be saying. You know, it makes no more sense than all the tall people sitting together and all the short people sitting together. We are just people. Bought with the blood of Jesus. Saved by his grace. And I long for the time when we stop looking at each other based on how we look on the outside. A judging folks based on how they look on the outside. When you put all that together, here's what you get. Because of that encounter, between Simon and Jesus, leading to his crucifixion. And scholars agree, Simon became a Christian. You never know the little trivial thing that can happen that can lead you to giving your life to Christ. And I know many of you have a story. Am I right? Come on, am I the only one? Me and Simon, the only ones got a story that seems small? Told you the story about, look, the Bible class taught by Lacey Mack in Tulsa, taught my mama. Because my mama got taught, her son got taught, her children got taught, Florence Edwards got taught. Amen, somebody. Yes. And because Florence Edwards got taught, Jocelyn got taught, Lewis Burton got taught, Joe Burton got taught. Joe Burton's one of the leaders of the church. Don't discount things that seem trivial. God can use it. Smile at somebody. Shake somebody's hand. Let's
see, things will be to you having an opportunity to help Jesus.
Yeah.
Simon was compelled to help him bear his cross. Because of the scourging, he lost a lot of blood, his body was weakened. He'd been up all night. Physically, could not bear the weight of the cross. Simon got the opportunity. Even though he didn't want it, he had to be compelled.
Yeah.
But got the opportunity to help Jesus bear his cross. Somebody said, well, what does that have to do with me? I'm going to give you this and be through. If you had the opportunity to help him, would you do it?
Wow.
And this is your takeaway.
Yeah.
This is what you got to do.
Would you help him?
I'm going to use an example of some people here at this congregation who are doing that. I hope it inspires all of us to get involved and help Jesus. Brother Matthews helped me the other Sundays talking about a scripture he said I should have used.
Amen! And I appreciate it.
He said, preacher, he said, the whole time I was waiting for you to use this.
When they hung him on the tree, it was to stamp out his name.
Yeah.
Folk who got crucified were the dregs of society. As a way to say to them, your life don't matter. And we're going to stamp out your name. Jesus had already said, I, be lifted up. It will not stand by my name. I'll draw all men.
That's a bit.
And then they were still mocking him. But now when Jesus said, Eli, Lama Sabbath, they said, this man called for Elijah. They knew. They knew better. He wasn't calling for Elijah. In fact, the writer says, what's being interpreted means, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? They knew, many of them were rabbis and priests. They knew that Jesus was calling out from Psalm 22.
Yes.
1,000 years before the events on Golgotha, David had written in Psalm 22, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?
Will you help him?
Will you help him? Declare his name.
Yes.
Declare his name to a lost, dying generation.
Yes, sir.
Tell somebody about it.
Yes.
Don't let his name be blotted out.
That's right.
Don't be ashamed.
That's right.
To tell somebody about Jesus.
Yes, sir.
Got a call last night. Just wanna tell some folk I'm proud of. I think that Helene. Yeah. She, I know you don't like the spotlight. I ain't trying to put you on front of the Would you stand where you are? Meet your son? Kevin Overton? Is Malik here? Malik, praise the Lord. Come up here with me, man. You just need to see how God can take the little stuff we do.
Yes, sir.
If you ever encourage this young man. See, he's walking like he don't want to go through. That's all right. I'm going to hug him anyway. I know he can be a handful. I know his posse can be a handful. But did you have encouragement?
Yes.
Did you pray for him? Yes. He'll see me come and sometimes go the other way because he know my ass, did you comb your hair? Did you put some lotion on your face? Oh, we have a time. Sometimes he stay mad at me in whole service. But he knows I love him. And God used these folk. Irma, what are you? Stand up, sweetheart, stand up. These people help to bring to faith Kim?
Kim Wilson.
Is Kim here?
She's at work.
Kim Wilson came to faith and was baptized into Christ. Kim is the mother. Baptistry to baptize her into Christ.
Yeah. Isn't that good?
Yeah.
Members need to have a good relationship with each other. Congregations need to have good relationship with each other. We're all the same church. Amen, somebody. And it's about helping each other. God can take little stuff.
Do amazing stuff.
God bless
you. I hate to mention this. Let's get ready to sing. Robert?
Yes, sir.
We're going to sing in just a minute. What you going to sing? While you think about it, let me say it. Trivial things can be used by the Holy Spirit to do wonderful things.
That's right.
But trivial things can also be used by the devil.
Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm.
To do some ugly stuff. Don't let trivial stuff get used by the devil to drive you away. So they didn't call you that. So they left and didn't shake you. Trivial needs to be used by the Holy Spirit to bless everybody.
Amen.
The devil will use it.
Yeah.
I heard it. Let's use the trivial to be a blessing to everybody. You never know what your phone call can do.
That's right. That's right. That's right.
What your car can do.
Yes.
You didn't see somebody. You missed them. How about instead of saying them leaders need to go see about something? So, how about you do it? They sure need to teach that person the gospel. How about you do it? That's why I'm proud of you. And the beauty is we have the rank and file doing some teaching.
Yes,
sir.
That's the way you can help her.
Yeah.
That's the way you can help Bears Cross. When is the last time you told somebody about the Lord that died for you?
Yeah.
Amen. Yes. I'm going to stop. I showed you how to tell you. And use this. Jesus said, if I be lifted up.
Yes.
The way he draws them is that you tell
somebody the story of the cross.
Yes.
And the way of the cross leads home. You're here this morning, you need to come to Jesus. We'll help you come. Is that right, church?
Yes.
If you need somebody to walk with you, we'll do that. Maybe I'm at the wrong place. Is that right?
Yes.
We'll do that. Somebody within this congregation, say within your spirit, I'm going to do whatever it takes, whatever I can do to help Jesus bear his cross. If you're here and you need us to pray with you, we'll be glad to do that. You need to come and give your life to Christ. You come on right now while we stand together.
Why did my Savior come to earth?